Hey Nathan, it's Monday, February 9th. Our world is full of amazing creatures, some who live on the edge of what we would call possible, and some that live even beyond that. These organisms are called extremophiles, and their prosperity living in what we consider to be extreme environments opens scientists' eyes to possibilities of life elsewhere in the universe. So what constitutes an extremophile? The word comes from the Latin root for extreme and the Greek for love, so they are organisms that love or thrive in harsh environments. They can be bacteria, archaea, or eukaryotic. So there's a large diversity amongst extremophiles, although most are going to be microbial archaea or bacteria. The simplicity of their makeup allows for easier adaptation to environments with intense temperature, high pressure, or lack of water, for example. Extremophiles live and thrive in physically or geochemically extreme places. These environments are too harsh for most living organisms on Earth. So an extreme environment would have high pressure or high radiation levels, high acidity or high alkalinity, high or low temperatures, high salinity, lack of water or lack of oxygen, or a lot of human waste like toxins or nuclear waste. And here's the catch. Most extremophiles can't survive very well or at all in what we would consider normal environments. For example, a thermophile can only live well in temperatures of 40 degrees Celsius or higher. Even though discovery of extremophiles only really began back in the 1960s, they've been invaluable to science. They're helping scientists figure out where life on Earth came from, since many of the environments that they live on resemble Earth's earliest stages. They also show us the possibilities and potentials of life on exoplanets, which harbor a plethora of extreme environments. It's surprising how much of our planet would be turned inhabitable by us soft, fleshy, and easily uncomfortable humans. Extremophiles, however, have evolved to thrive in whatever extreme their environment leans toward. They can be found near super hot hydrothermal vents at the deep, deep ocean floor, or on the tops of icy mountains or fiery volcanoes. They can be found in waterless deserts or oxygenless slimes or super salty or acidic lakes. You can find them at the bottom of lakes, found under the ice of Antarctica. Extremophiles have even been found living in rocks 2,000 feet under the ocean floor. Like I said earlier, most extremophiles are going to be bacteria or archaea, but some of them are animals, which I'm going to show a few examples of now because they're slightly more interesting to look at slash easier to picture in our heads. These guys are impressive in particular because it's a bit harder for their complex body systems like enzymes and amino acids to adapt to these harsh extremes. To start, let's look at the Pompeii worm. It was discovered in the early 1980s next to hydrothermal vents in the Pacific Ocean. One of the most heat-tolerant animals on Earth, this 5-inch long worm thing has its tail end constantly in 80 degrees Celsius water, while its head end is in more temperate 22 degrees Celsius. It is thought that their survival is due in part to bacteria that live on their backs, which help with insulation. But regardless, the fact that they can live with these two temperature extremes and just in these high temperatures in general is pretty impressive. Going from the deep, hot ocean vents to the cold mountaintops, we'll find the Gryloblattidae. These little ant-like bugs were discovered in the early 1900s, and they live under rocks or amongst decaying leaves in super, super cold high altitudes, like in forests, mountaintops, or even glaciers. Called ice crawlers or ice bugs, they like it between 1 to 4 degrees Celsius, not any warmer or colder. The Antarctic krill is also an amazing creature that lives in the sea around, you guessed it, Antarctica. The temperatures of these waters, as you can guess, stays pretty cold and goes back and forth between just above freezing and just below freezing. These tiny krill, however, are a keystone species for the Antarctic ecosystem. They provide food for a lot of bigger animals like birds and sea mammals and lots of different kinds of fish, while at the same time they are the main predator for a lot of smaller protoplankton or algae that they scrape off the bottom of Antarctic ice. It's so crazy to me to imagine such a tiny animal being such an important part of an ecosystem of such a big area of the Earth, but it happens, and it's because of their ability to adapt to these extreme environments that they make the whole system work. Nathan, I love how science can take a look at a part of nature that seems like it would have no benefit to us to give us clues to our past and our future. Let's hope we discover more extremophiles that help us answer questions about both our beginnings and what lies ahead. We'll see you on Wednesday.